Karen, welcome to the show. Thank you for calling and thanks for holding.
Thank you, Jesse.
You're welcome.
I think you're amazing.
Oh.
I'm new and to your show and to you, and I just love it. It's wonderful.
I appreciate that. How did you find the show?
It was when you did a clip, it was circulating on Instagram about Amber Rose's slut walk.
Oh, the slut. The slut.
It was, you said the slut maker. That was great.
What is it like living in Costa Rica? What is that life like?
Well, I'm actually from Toronto, Canada, but I've been here 7 months now. It's incredible. The time does not go back here.
Right.
They don't change the time at all.
Thank God.
Yeah, but I actually miss it because now it always gets dark before 6 every single day of the year.
And oh.
I love that extra stretch of sun, you know. In the
Me too. That's the only thing I like. I like the fact that they moved it forward, but I wish they would leave it there forever. Because I like the daylight. I'm not a dark man. I'm not into the darkness.
Yeah, me neither.
What made you decide to move to Costa Rica?
It was on a whim. Well, it actually has a lot to do with my question, to be honest.
Okay.
And it was, I came here on vacation with my son last year. And then 9 months later, I packed up my bags and we sold everything. I'm back here with my son. It's just a simpler life. It feels like how life felt back in the 80s, you know.
Yeah.
Everyone is very it's very family oriented, and everyone, you know, acknowledges each other, says good morning, you know. It's really just a great vibe.
How old is your son?
He's 22.
Oh, okay. All right, so you have a question for me. Go ahead.
Yes. I'm having an incredibly difficult time forgiving my father. He's part of the reason, my family is part of the reason why I'm here. My mother had died recently, a couple years ago. And, my family was always strange, and me and my father were always distant from the time I, you know, got into puberty. They had me older, like they were pushing 50. My dad actually was around 50 and change when I was born.
Right.
I have 3 older brothers that I don't have a connection really with.
Right.
Because I wasn't allowed to because I was so young.
Right.
Also, my parents are like Caribbean background. My father's Portuguese and my mother's Guyanese, but we mainly grew up Caribbean background.
Right.
Guyana has that influence of the Caribbean. So very old school parents, born very, had me very late. And so obviously it's hard to relate, right?
Right.
So growing up, me and my father were really close when I was young, inseparable actually. And me and my mother, well, I was a loving child towards everybody. My father, I can see now what happened. Now that my mom has passed, I didn't know. I just thought they were just older. They didn't get it. They're Caribbean, you know, it's just the culture difference and whatever.
Right.
But now that my mom has passed, all my brothers stopped talking to me. My father stopped talking to me. I was never allowed to see any will. Like, I know this has to do, it has probably to do with secrets and money. I don't even know what's going on. But on my mom's deathbed, they couldn't wait to unplug her. I don't even know what happened. Like, I've always been out of the loop. They've always left me out of the loop. And so again, when on my mother's deathbed, when I asked them, can I have a minute alone with my mom? And my dad wouldn't give it to me. And then everybody else did. They left the room, but my dad would not. And then finally, I'm like, Dad, please, can just 5 minutes to say goodbye to her before you pull her off the plug. And And he got all upset and he went around the curtain. And I swear the man gave me less than 60 seconds and said, that's enough time for you. It's just everything my whole life, I've always known him to be taking from me or blocking me. And so I've never, like, I've
have
had
you ever asked him why?
By my, sorry?
Have you ever asked him why did he do that?
Oh, I ask him all the time. He always says, like, well, you're like this, you're like that. But I had to leave the house at 16. And, like, not because I'm rebellious or anything. It was because I was in jail. It felt like an insane asylum prison because everybody, my dad pretty much tortured my mom. My mom was a strong woman. Like, don't get me wrong. She would fight back, but like he just made her, he now knowing now what I know, like, now that she's passed, I realized my father, they wanted everyone to turn against her and think she was crazy. And I did think my mom was crazy growing up. Like, I had a better relationship with her, but
why did you think she was crazy? Why did you think she was crazy?
She would say odd things. You know what I mean? She was just, I think she went a little crazy only because she, my dad told everyone she's crazy because my dad's doing that to me now. And I think, again, it has to do with greed or I don't know. I have no idea. I don't know who my father is.
Here's what I recommend. No, I would get with my father, meet somewhere, the two of you, and just ask why. Don't yell at him. Don't argue. Just ask him to fill in the blanks on what you did not understand between he and your mother while you were growing up. And once he explained it, it would give you a better understanding. Then you would feel better.
But yes, he won't explain it. My family is based on a lot of lies. I know nothing.
Well, like, here's what I recommend. Well, you forgive him anyway. Don't hold anything against him because whatever's going on, well, he can help himself. As your mother could not help herself, and as you cannot help yourself doing the things that you should not do or wish you had not done, right? Yeah. And so just forgive your father. He can't help it.
So if I forgive him in the ether, like within myself now, I can do that. That's easy. But must I forgive him in person?
If you can, of course, is always the best way to go to him and forgive him in person. But if you can't, then just realize he can't help it and forgive him. But don't run away from having to face him if you can face him.
Okay.
Especially while he's alive, it's best to do it because you're...
I know.
Yeah. Let me ask. So you moved to Costa Rica because your son lived there?
No. We just left. He was living with me. But it was just because they were, it's like we're Amish. I've been shunned for nothing.
And he's 21 years old?
I don't even know. My son is 22, yeah.
22. Why is he still living with you at 22?
He's autistic, high functioning.
He's what?
High functioning autism.
And so he has a lot of energy?
No. How can I explain this? He's just socially and he's not really good, but incredible genius, very smart brain, like at certain things, but some things, autism, it's there's all different levels.
So will you have to take care of him the rest of your life?
Pretty much, yeah.
What does that feel like? Yeah. What is that like knowing you got to take care of him the rest of your life?
Sometimes it's stressful mentally, but not really. He's amazing, and he's the only thing I've really known that shows pure love. And he's like, if you ever met this child or spoke to him, you'd be totally impressed. He is a child of God. He's pure as pure can be.
And so he's not able to live on his own?
No, he can, but... as far as, like, I would still have to try to help, like, I'd still have to pay bills, like, help him with bills. I'd still have to, like, like, he wouldn't know how to pay the bill. Do you know what I mean? Like, I would have to.
So, God forbid, what would happen to him if you should expire? What would happen to him?
Oh, he is loved. There's not one human on this. And plus, I've done a lot of things in my life where I'm very much I'm respected in back in Toronto. And a lot of people would help him. Everybody, everyone would.
Amazing.
Even my father, you can't hate this kid. He's just amazing.
Oh, okay. Amazing. Yeah. And where is his father?
His father's in Canada. That's another, I've got a lot of strange life stories. And his father just, age of 18, said, "You're a man now. You don't need your father anymore." And he stopped talking to him. And my son was in shock. He didn't expect that because he thought his dad was awesome when he came around whenever he felt like it. And he was awesome whenever he came around when he felt like it. But then I think his father wanted to stop paying child support, and the government, or not the government, the courts wouldn't allow him because he owed so much anyway. So he was trying to say, well, I don't talk to him.
Were you married to the father? Were you married?
Full of bamboozle.
Were you married to the father?
Never, no.
Oh, so you had him out of wedlock?
I did.
And do you want the father to be with him?
Oh, yes, of course. Like, I've never stopped that. I don't do that.
Okay. Well, here's,
I love family, like, because I'm not allowed to have one. So I love family very much.
Yeah, Karen, here's what I recommend for you. Do what you want, of course, but I would... make sure if you can't get with your father and hear him out, and whether he's right or wrong, forgive him. I would let whatever you feel about him go. Don't hold on to the anger, and forgive your mother too. And then your life will start to change. Have you done my silent prayer yet?
I haven't looked. No, I haven't. I don't know where it is, but I keep hearing you mentioning it.
It's on silentprayer.video. Silentprayer.video. I highly recommend you do it morning and night. It's going to be amazing. And read my book, From Rage to Responsibility. And I talk about how I was able to overcome all the stuff that I had to deal with when I was in that fallen state. It's amazing.
Yeah.
So you can overcome it. You just have to focus on watch yourself so you can overcome.
Yes.
So read From Rage to Responsibility. You can get it from Amazon, or you can order from my website, rebuildingtheman.com, or call 800-411-BOND. And let me know how it goes when you forgive your father, all right?
I will. And thank you so much for everything that you're doing. Please keep going. It's wonderful.
I will. God bless you. Call me again, Karen.
I will. Thank you, Jesse.
You're welcome. Amazing. Clown Report says, I'll call sometime. I can tell you about autism. My daughter has it. I'll do anything to make it that she did not have it. I'll do anything to make it that she did not have it. Oh, okay. I'm not a doctor. So don't take this as medical advice. But I personally believe, now it's just Jesse Peterson belief, because I believe that there is nothing in life that you cannot overcome, that you can overcome all things if you believe and don't doubt. You can overcome all things if you believe and don't doubt, right? I believe that you can overcome autism or anything. I believe that autism is due to the overreaction of the mother while she was pregnant with the child. Because sometimes if the mother is angry or too emotional, or even when the child first born and not patient with the child, it can cause the child to overreact, become angry, but can't express his or herself. And that will create that that anxiousness that they grow up with. And the reason I believe that you can overcome it, because I've dealt with autism boys and girls, young men and women, and those who have let the anger go by forgiving have been able to get better. I don't want to say that they got 100% better, but they definitely changed. They start to calm down. They start to remember things rather than leaving things everywhere. They become less anxious. But if you don't believe that your kids can overcome, young adult kids can overcome, then they're not. Because a lot of parents teach the children that you can't help it, baby. That's just the way you are. You can't help it. You've made that way. People just don't understand. And that's pretty sad. And some of these people say they believe in God, but yet they don't believe you can overcome all things. I'm telling you, it's amazing. But that's just my food for thought. Smoke on it. James.
Yes.
Do you believe that you can overcome autism?
Yeah.
What I notice about parents who have children who are autistic,
yeah,
they baby these kids. They smother them. They don't allow them to be responsible for themselves.
Yeah, I think they really exacerbate the problem.
And that hurt. Yeah, that make it worse.
Mm-hmm. I've heard that it's associated, too, with some of these vaccinations.
Yeah, I heard about that, too.
Yeah.
And I believe it's the mothers more than the father who really, even though I've seen fathers do it,
uh-huh,
too,
yeah,
but who really overly protected of children when they're growing up with autism.
Yeah.
And so when they become adults, the kids can't even function because mama got your back and so does daddy.
And they have this permanent excuse in their minds, and
yeah,
it's like hard to separate them from it.
Yeah, they've been told over and over again that you're artistic, so that's the way you are, you can't help it.
Yeah.
And so the kids start believing it, and when they become an adult, they can't get away from that belief.
And they'll get mad at you if you don't accept that excuse.
Right.
It's a shame.
It sure is. Amazing. Amazing. Well, thank you, James.
Yeah.
What do you think about those folk getting upset about the president signing a Bible?
They're hypocrites. They're Pharisees. There was one, I was reading the quote from some female reverend, Donnie something, which is a woman, complaining that the Bible is very important to her faith. Saying it was a political ploy. I think her complaint is a political ploy.
Who said that?
A female reverend, Bobby something.
She's not a real reverend.
Right.
A reverend sent by Satan.
Yeah.
That's crazy to say that.
I'll send her name to your producer. Maybe she'll come on the show.
Yeah, let's try to get her on. I would love to talk to her.
Yeah.
Also, one last thing about kids that have the so-called autism.
Mm-hmm.
The parents don't really give them a chance to be on their own either. They keep up with, even as an adult, they keep up with every detail of their life.
Yeah, really bad.
Yeah.
And then they give them the easy way out all the time. If they lose credit cards or something, they get the easy way out, so they get it replaced, so they don't care. They don't really suffer the consequences.
Right, they have no consequences in their lives.
And so it's like no big deal to them losing stuff all the time. They don't like it, but it's not a big enough deal that they suffer for it and are forced to like try to focus and change.
It's amazing.
Mm-hmm.
It's amazing. It's amazing. Another ism.
By the way, oh yeah, good point. Autism. No such thing. But